So to start off, maybe let's just paint a quick picture. So imagine it's a Monday afternoon, you just finished work or school, you're tired and you're going home, but you realize you have to buy groceries. So go to your local supermarket, and because you like to make these discounts, you really want to get as much as you can, and either freeze or store away whatever's left. The supermarket is already used up some of your evenings, so you rush home, you can tie your keys, take off your shoes. So what's the first thing you do after that? Well, maybe you put it in the fridge, right? Well, millions of people around the world don't have that option. And so let's take a look into that. So it is estimated that 25 to 50% of the food that is produced in the world actually goes to waste. And a report given by the United Nations says that 795 million people out of 7.3 billion, that is to say one in every nine people, suffer from chronic undernourishment. That's only between 2014 and 2016.
So like you've heard here today, there's lots of reasons for that. But if you take a look at the picture here, one of those reasons is access to electricity. So if you just kind of take a look at the picture, you can see that certain areas of the world, so sub-Saharan Africa or parts of Asia, really lack this access to electricity. And 95% of those are in rural or developing communities. What you might not see is that even in certain areas that do have patchy access to the electricity grid, the access isn't reliable enough in order to provide adequate
So bit Winchell, this unit over here will hold 40 degrees Fahrenheit temperature inside the refrigeration unit. This temperature is perfect to keep the food good for a longer period of time. Our design has won the student division of the Global Biomimicry Challenge, and we're currently part of the Biomimicry Accelerator Program in order to make this thing this dream come true. Initially, our design has three main parts. So the first one will be the wind funnel where the wind goes in. Then we have the condensation chamber or evaporation chamber. And then the refrigeration unit as itself. We've designed this so most of our materials can be recycled materials. So it has very little impact in the environment. Winchell has already caught the eye of many. Our design has been featured by Business Insider. They made a short, simple video where they explained how it works. And this video got over 2 million hits in Facebook and YouTube. It has also been featured in many articles in Canada. And it was recently featured on a TV show by a big US network.
So I'm gonna use that graphic that they made. I'm trying to explain a little bit about how it works, just a brief overview. So on your right there, as the picture mentioned, you have your wind collector. So basically, this is a funnel structure which accelerates the air into the tubing, which is then on the ground. So as the air starts to go underground, it's cooled by virtue of obviously underground being the deeper underground you go, the more constant temperature around the world you get, the cooler it starts to cool the air. After going through a couple of coils, it then goes into what we call our evaporation chamber. What you don't see in this simplified graphic is three things. One is that the water level isn't actually that high, and the little thing is actually much lower so that it doesn't cover the coils. Two is that we have a protective sheeting that protects the actual coils so that the sun doesn't heat them up. And three, there's a small solar powered or gravity powered fan that blows wind or air. And it blows wind over the coils to help it evaporate, and then by that process, we get evaporative cooling, cools down the air inside the water. So then it goes back underground, and finally into the container. So as was mentioned in the title of the presentation, we really want this to be more than just a product or a device. We want it to be functioning as a system. And so to do that, we are taking a look at tackling the issue on three main levels. The first is on the device. And so this is our information flow level. So obviously the exact same unit would work in a tropical environment like a jungle than it would work in somewhere like a desert or even a developing community that's going towards urban. And so in every single instance where Windchill is installed, we take the lessons learned and modifications that have been made and we store them in a central knowledge base to kind of make that global network. The next step is in the community. So we don't just want to, you know, go to a community, give them a box of parts, shake hands, feel good, and then say goodbye. And, you know, that doesn't give lasting change. What we want to do is empower our community. So in this top graphic, you can see Jill, one of our partners, that actually went to Ghana, community in Ghana, and in that talk with Jill, she's talking to a welder and a translator. And in the bottom line, she's speaking with engineers in Ghana. And so this brings availability of maybe new jobs in manufacturing, assembly, installation, maintenance, and improvement in design. And also even in Isaac Victor mentioned, parts of this unit were designed to be made from recycled or reusable parts. And so the hope of that is that in making more of these, we can also help somewhat clean the environment. The last level is in the financial or operational flow. And so we actually recently got to talk to a really inspirational person, Christopher Ateka. He was a really interesting individual. He was from Uganda, and he went from being an orphan to a couple of years ago being named on Forbes' top 30 under 30. And he started really similar charities and social enterprises, similar to the ones spoken today by Professor Lee. And the advice that he gave us was that while it's really good to seek grants, sponsors and donors in the initial stages, if you really want to be self-sustaining, you have to try and find a way to, you know, get the funds in a different way. So how we thought of tackling that problem was making commercial models, so ones that might be attractive to outdoor leisure or urban sectors, and using those profits to drive the social enterprise blessing. And so here's a couple pictures of the first unit in Ghana, so you can see how it translates from the graphic over to real life. So putting in some food and assemble it outside.
So for any project, you need a good team. And in this case, this is our team. Moyan Egemon, she's a professor at the University of Calgary. She specializes in design and biomimicry, and she's been our main advisor for this project. Then we have Jorge, as you already mentioned, George. He's our director of development. Sister Chang, who couldn't be here, she's our technical director. And myself, Victor, operations director. But also, I have to thank a group of people who developed the first model. And that would be Cecily again, Michelle, Jorge, and Mitchell Webb. Again, thank you very much for listening to our presentation. If you have any questions, please let us know.
We have installed three
questions. One in Canada, which we actually got to, we were able to freeze water, but I think that's just because it was winter in Canada. But actually, the first one in the ground was in Ghana. So
yeah.
So far, so see what we're working towards some partnerships in India.
Great technology innovation used for great social purpose. Yes, I don't know, Pat. This is the most workable solution so far. This afternoon. How much is it going to cost to you?
Yeah, a great question. So the very first unit that we made, that we submitted to the competition that we were part of, I spent 16 Canadian dollars, and Canadian to Hong Kong dollars is about 1 to 7.8. So it's about that conversion. And that was the most expensive part is the copper coils. The entire rest of it, I was able to make out of recycled material. So it was actually, I used aluminum pop cans, a great heat conductor, plastic tile from
I don't know, or anything, but just refuge and things like that. But the next unit, new prototype that we actually just made, all in all, it was $120 Canadian dollars.
So that's around less than $100 American to take Canadian out.
Less
than $100 US.
So US dollars for complete.
For the second prototype, we have to take those numbers down. It's just the second prototype.
How affordable that is in your country? $100 US for that. Is it affordable?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to hear any other comments, questions, questions. Do you have a question?
So is it essentially like a closed loop geothermal system that you're using to keep it cold? And then how do you make sure that it's actually deep enough in the ground?
This student is actually from University of Ohio. She went and she made a formal report, technical report in general. She did suggest we had it 1.3 meters in the ground, I think we first had it. And she suggested putting it deeper in the ground. So that would be a matter of trial and error, more data collection, which we just haven't been able to do in the first one. But one important point that you brought up was that the inside of the evaporation chamber, that is a closed loop condensation evaporation cycle, so that people don't want to see in areas where water is scarce, so it has to be constantly over there.
Okay,
yes.
So
we've seen a few different strategies that people in places with electricity grid are using, and one very famous one, I think that some people might know, is called a pot in pot. It's a big pot with some water or sand, and then a smaller pot inside, and that's their fridge. So this is kind of typical.
You said it costs $100.
It costs $100 with all new materials in buying them from, you know, a department store in Canada, which is expensive.
So I'm now thinking about using it for vaccines rather than
Actually, that's one of our. So, as George mentioned before, the first main idea was to create a refrigeration unit for the people who didn't have access to electricity, right? But then we came to the conclusion, like, okay, doing this, we're going to need either to put our own money in or ask for donations, and we don't. It's okay to receive donations, but we don't want to depend. So we wanted to expand this to a commercial product, and one of the options is actually that, it's a distribution. Another option will be something like a wine cooler / cellar. This is a perfect application for that, for someone who's willing to pay for it. And it's something that maybe a second fridge, right? There's many people, especially in the US and Canada, who have two fridges for big families, and you know, there's an extra cost to the electricity for that second fridge, so this could be an option for them.
But your idea of vaccine, thank you, that's
huge. Yeah.
Is keeping vaccines in those areas where it's very hot, it can spoil your electricity.
Yeah. Thank you.
Because the question is in line with that, it's about capacity.
Yes.
It looks quite small.
Yeah.
So what kind of plan is it?
That's a good point. So part of that depends on one, how deep you put the coils, the tubing. And also the average wind speeds in whichever area you're putting. So, and in Ghana, we did some research in the submission for about that size. So if you want to scale it up, the issue is, you know, getting wind flow or without, you know, having to go hundreds or whatever meters deep. So the size constraint is in how cold the evaporative cooling system will actually be.
Okay, one more question. In the communities in which you install these things,
yes.
Do you actually teach the community how to assemble it, how to maintain it?
Yes. And the idea, yeah, great question, and thank you. And actually, one of the ideas that we were not only in hope to maintain it, but to make more manufactured is, well, one of the parts of it, sorry, was a high ratio gear box that would replace the panel or obviously access to the grid. And to do that, to manufacture the actual parts, there's an option of installing just an easy injection molding factory, small little building, in those communities to make sure the knowledge stays there and there's communication back and forth. So, yeah.
Is that the ideal environmental conditions to
required for people like, and what is the flexibility in those conditions? For example, say, if wind speed is very low, then what will happen to this bike?
Yeah, so one of the biggest factors, typically, if you want to call it, is the humidity. Humidity is huge. If it's way too humid, the evaporative cooling actually is really low in emissions. And so that's where adding new parts that come from knowledge burnt at each instance of it, each data point, can come really handy. Right now, this is the first one that we have, okay, so we're learning, so we'll
it's way more complex system. You get two layers of
cooling.
So, okay, you
to work on the flexibility, and then
you
can go
somewhere.
You have?
Anyway,
I think
you have. Have. Okay, what's
well,
sorry.
Am I right to say that it's fixed on the ground?
Yes.
It's, so, and do you think there is a potential to make it carryable?
Carryable?
As in,
yeah.
I believe there is a huge potential if people could take it with them to the market where they sell their fruits. Most likely in the sun.
Absolutely.
So the idea is actually the first commercial product that we're attacking. It would be a cooler for people that go camping. So instead of using ice, you can just use this device. So we're hopefully going to develop a way to go around that. And if we can apply it to that commercial product, then yes, that will be applied later. But yeah, right now we don't have the. It's good, but we don't have the resources to kind of attack everything at the same time. So we have to kind of control ourselves and go through one route. And then once we develop the capital, then for sure.